From the creators of the popular science show with millions of YouTube subscribers comes the Minute Earth podcast. Every episode of the show dives deep into a science question you might not even know you had. But once you hear the answer, you'll want to share it with everyone you know. Why do rivers curve? Why did the T-Rex have such tiny arms? And why do so many more kids need glasses now than they used to? Spoiler alert, it isn't screen time. Our team of scientists digs into the research and breaks it down into a short, entertaining explanation, jam-packed with science facts and terrible puns. Subscribe to Minute Earth wherever you like to listen.
Hi, friends. Are you looking for a new podcast? Maybe something you can share with your littles? Something that has some storytelling in it? Well, then look no further. We have Storytime with Philip and Mommy, where my son and I sit and discuss all the great books that you might love while we read them. So, Little Golden Books, Berenstain Bears, and even the new classics like Bluey. We sit down, we read, we discuss, and we have so much fun doing it. Come and join us. Subscribe wherever you get your podcasts.
You're listening to an Airwave Media Podcast.
Hey, Mick, my name's Brennan, and I live in Collingswood, New Jersey, which is right next to Haddonfield, where they dig up dinosaur bones. My favorite episode is episode 25... Fakes and Frauds. Congrats on your 100th episode!
Thanks, buddy. Let's rock! Well, here we are! It's the 100th episode of The Past and the Curious. My name is Mick Sullivan, as it has been for the last 100 episodes. And it's going to stay that name. That's going to be my name. It's always my name. So thank you all for joining. Thank you all. If this is a regular thing for you, well, we've made it to 100, haven't we? We're going to hear from listeners throughout the show, which is really exciting and super fun for me. So just know that that's happening in between most of the bits. There's two really great stories this month. One of them I've been kind of holding on to for a long time, and I'm excited to share it. It's the story of a horse known as Beautiful Jim Key, who was remembered as the smartest horse in history. So I think you're really going to enjoy that. And then the other story in this episode is really fascinating, about a woman who worked in a museum. It's always near and dear to my heart, in South Africa, and she made a startling discovery, an animal that was believed to be extinct, but was not extinct. More on that later.
Hi, Meg. Happy 100th episode. I'm Keegan. I'm 8 years old, and I live in Corbett, Oregon. We love listening to The Past and the Curious in the car, and our whole family learns a lot. I have listened to every episode, and my favorite one was the baseball one about Jackie Mitchell. I thought it was interesting that she struck out Babe Ruth and Lou Gehrig. Bye, Mick. Love your show.
Have you ever seen a horse make change, like the cashier when you pay for an ice cream cone with a crumpled $5 bill? Do you think a stallion can spell surnames? Could a filly tell time? Has there ever been a Mustang who could do math? It sounds absurd, but it's estimated that between 1897 and 1906, 10 million people saw a horse named Beautiful Jim Key do all of this and more. Beautiful Jim Key was an extraordinary equine. So extraordinary, in fact, that people of his day and age considered him to be as smart as an average human second grader. Of course, in addition to his remarkable brain power, his natural horsepower meant he could have easily beaten a classroom full of second graders in a foot race to boot. Take that, kids! Smart and fast. Or at least faster than a human kid. Beautiful Jim Key's unique abilities weren't always obvious. When he first came into the world in 1889, Jim Key was a sickly and weak little foal. No one expected him to amount to much. If he even lived, it was clear that he wasn't gonna win any horse races. Before this brilliant horse came along, his trainer, a man named William Key, had been enslaved in Tennessee. William earned a reputation for his own brilliance. His brilliance was in working with animals. After the Civil War brought freedom to William and millions of others, this man worked as a veterinarian and a trainer. He became known as Dr. William Key. and kindness and patience were the cornerstones of his approach to training a horse. Horses were pretty essential to life in much of America at this time, and people all over Tennessee called on Dr. William when they had any horse troubles of their own. William found beautiful Jim's mother languishing in a traveling circus sometime in the 1880s. She was special, and William knew it. She was known as Loretta, Queen of Horses, which is quite a name. But it wasn't just a magniloquent moniker. According to legend, she had once been the pride of the stable for a wealthy sheik in Persia. A descendant of horses owned by great pharaohs, stories even said. But a sneaky man from England couldn't help himself and saw the fortune that he could earn with such a remarkable horse. So he daringly stole her in the night. He earned the fortune that he dreamt of when he sold Loretta to American entertainer P.T. Barnum. But Barnum didn't keep her forever. She was sold several more times, each time to a lower and lower quality group of traveling entertainers. It was years later that William found her languishing in a failing traveling circus. You'd have never known that she was one of the most incredible horses to ever live. Sadly, she was sick and depressed and had been abused. So William bought her and devoted himself to her care. Dr. Key nursed her back to health and did all he could to give such a remarkable horse the life that she deserved. And when Loretta gave birth to a colt, Dr. William Key was certain that it would be a strong, brilliant horse. Was he right? He was worse than right. He was wrong, at least at first. No one who saw the puny little horse, known as Jim Key, held any hope for the gangly and sickly creature. They pointed at his malformed legs.
There's no way that he'll ever race.
Heck, friends and neighbors talked openly about how unlikely he was to survive at all. Many called him ugly.
Well, I say.
Dr. William saw these things too, but he never gave up on Jim Key. There's a reason the horse is not remembered as ugly Jim Key. Jim might not have been the racehorse that everyone expected, but there were other special things about him. Jim Key's unusual nature first showed up not long after Loretta, Queen of Horses, died. Without his mother, the young horse was eager for connection, and after watching how the dogs on the farm interacted with Dr. William, the horse began to mimic their behavior. He even got so good at acting like a dog that he insisted on living in the house with Jim's family and the other indoor pets. And if you're wondering, the answer is yes, Jim was housebroken. But unlike most dogs, Jim could open the door for himself. Sometimes the urge would strike and he'd just head out for a ramble to the countryside before returning home for dinner or for lights out. Dr. Key began giving the horse some special attention, training him in simple tasks in a barn behind the house. After accomplishing a task, Dr. Key would reward beautiful Jim with an apple that he kept in a drawer. Something peculiar happened once after Dr. Key had finished one of the training sessions and left the horse alone in the barn. Beautiful Jim must have felt safely alone, and he must have really enjoyed those apples because the horse confidently walked over to the desk, opened the reward drawer with his mouth, snagged a delicious apple to chow down upon in solitude. Dr. William happened to see this through the window. Opening the drawer to get the apples was impressive, but not totally surprising to the doctor. However, he was truly startled to see the horse close the drawer afterwards. The clever creature was covering his tracks. He was an observant animal. When William's wife discovered that the horse could answer yes or no questions with the nod or a shake of the head, she knew something was not normal about this horse living in their home. Sure, having a horse living in the home and acting like a dog was probably a pretty big giveaway in the first place, but the fact that he had learned to give answers simply by observing, not through his training, was truly remarkable. With this new revelation, Dr. William Key started to work constantly with the horse. Apples, sugar cubes, patience, kindness, rewards. Those were some of the keys to unlock Jim Key's genius. More importantly, both William, the trainer, and Jim, the horse, were incredibly intelligent, and they both cared very much about one another. Originally, the pair performed as a part of William's traveling medicine show, in which the horse was trained to do a bit of acting as William sold his homemade medical remedy called Keystone Liniment. Before long, however, all of the focus was on Jim, who was soon officially known as Beautiful Jim Key. Once realizing that Jim was far from ordinary, William planned to teach Jim the alphabet, one letter at a time. Maybe they'd make it to 26. Maybe they wouldn't. But before long, Jim could recognize and identify every letter from A to Z. Well, okay, how about numbers? William must have thought. No problem, Jim would have replied, if he could have spoken, of course, but he couldn't. He was a horse. At the age of 7, Beautiful Jim performed with Dr. Key at the 1897 World's Fair in Nashville. It was their most important performance to date, and the audience could not believe what they were seeing. By pointing at large cards with his nose, Beautiful Jim Key could spell names, sort mail alphabetically, even do basic arithmetic. See what I mean about a second grader? Beautiful Jim did his homework, and William was a good teacher. Of course, throughout their career, and still today, some people believed that it was a hoax. Many think there is no way a horse could do these things. But Dr. William would tell anyone who asked that he was a kind and patient trainer. And when you put that together with an unnaturally smart animal, the sky's the limit. Plenty of doubters went looking for clues about a hoax, but no one ever found a shred of evidence that Jim and William were frauds. They performed for famous people like Booker T. Washington and President McKinley. They thrilled groups of school children and millions of Americans at fairs and concert halls. And at the 1904 World's Fair in St. Louis, they were the highest grossing act at the entire celebration. Dr. Key and a business partner even wrote a play for Jim to star in, which toured theaters and thrilled audiences, making him one of the earliest animal actors. To prove he was a star, consider this. This horse, Beautiful Jim Key, traveled by private rail car with two grooms and a guard dog named Monk. Once astray, Monk became a constant companion for the horse. He was often found perched on Jim's back, and was usually ready to chase off the press if the horse wasn't in the mood to be seen or was busy working with Dr. Key. During his life, Doc was one of the most visible and recognizable African-American men in the country, and he went out of his way to schedule performances for black audiences in many places where they were typically not allowed. And as for the influence of Beautiful Jim, more important than impressing people with intellect and ability, Beautiful Jim Key taught the world the value of treating animals with kindness. Inspired by the famous relationship between Jim and William, millions of school children signed the Beautiful Jim Pledge. The pledge began like this. I will try to be kind to all harmless living creatures and try to protect them from cruel usage. Jim Key was also inspirational and foundational to the many humane societies that were organized in America at this time. Thanks to his celebrity, Beautiful Jim Key first raised awareness in the minds of many about the need to treat animals not as tools or as beasts, but as living creatures worthy of respect and kindness.
All you need is a few minutes to start your day off with something historic when you listen to the This Day in History podcast. Every day, there's a new episode for you to listen and learn about what happened that day way back when. Today could be the day a famous mobster met their end, or the first milestone for humans in space. Who knows what history today holds? Find out when you listen and subscribe to This Day in History wherever you get your podcasts. That's This Day in History wherever you get your podcasts.
We're the All Creatures Podcast. Each week, Angie and I explore and share amazing details about the many animals we share our world with.
Plus, Chris and I are both PhD scientists and educators. So we do the deep dives in the scientific research and then come back and share what we learn in a fun and casual way. We also speak with other scientists, animal experts, activists, and many other conservation enthusiasts from all over the planet.
So you can find the All Creatures Podcast wherever you get your podcasts.
Hi, Nick. This is Bennett. I live in Texas, and I really like your underwear chronicles. It makes me and my mom laugh. They're really funny. Thanks for putting on such a great show. We love your show. Thank you.
For You Have 30 Seconds this month, we are going to hear from Anthony, who's going to tell us about the Wade Dahl Till Shunt, which has to do with a medical apparatus and Roald Dahl, world-renowned author.
My name is Anthony. I have 30 seconds about Roald Dahl. Dustin Theo got injured and needed a shunt to drain extra bone fluid. The shunt could get clogged too easily. Dahl's friend Stanley Wade was a hydraulic engineer. Dahl introduced Wade to Theo's doctor, Dr. Till. Together, those three invented a new shunt that worked better. The three inventors agreed not to make money from their invention. They just wanted it to help people. I have a shunt, and I love Roald Dahl's books.
Anthony, that was awesome. I'm so glad that that was the You Have 30 Seconds for our 100th episode. I had no idea about that. It's so awesome. It's so awesome that they didn't want to make money off of it. They just wanted to help people. It's so awesome that it was Roald Dahl's son that was the impetus for this, and it's so awesome because I love Roald Dahl's books too. In fact, we have a whole set of his books, and I read them with my sons all the time. We've read, I don't know, 6 or 7 of his books. Favorites in the house. Great work, Anthony. Thank you so much. I'm so glad it was something that was so important to you too. That really came through. Great work.
Hey, Nick. My name's Dakota, and I really like your show, and I'm 3 years old, and I really like your ice cream. Thank you. Dun, dun, dun.
It's quiz time. It's quiz time. It's quiz time. Time, time.
Well, here we are. It's quiz time, episode 100. Over the years, we have featured quite a few animals on this show, and since this is our 100th episode, I thought we could use this as an opportunity to look back at some past episodes to test your memory. Or, if you're new and you haven't made it through the entire Passin' the Curious catalog yet, it'll just be a typical quiz time and a taste of what else there is to find in the feed. So, question number one. Way back in episode 11, we shared the story of Annie Edson Taylor, a woman who conquered Niagara Falls inside of a pickle barrel. It was her 63rd birthday. Before authorities could let her attempt this stunt, however, they wanted to know that it was safe-ish. Who did she send over first to prove it was possible? First off, it's not safe, nor safe-ish. Very dangerous, as you might imagine. But prior to her successful attempt going over Niagara Falls in a pickle barrel, she put her pet cat into the customized barrel. Perhaps she figured that cats always land on their feet, so maybe that was a good idea. Luckily, the cat survived, and luckily Annie did too. Still, I do not recommend trying to replicate any part of this story. But I do recommend listening to that episode if you haven't. Okay, question number two. There's a disagreement in the dog world about who the greatest traveler of the species would be. However, I vote for the dog in episode 46. So what dog traveled around the country by train car and around the world aboard steamships? It was a dog named Oni, who became the official mascot for the U.S. Postal Service. After first wandering onto a mail train in Albany, New York, he became a fixture on rail lines and traveled around America to much fanfare, and he had metal charms from each location to prove it. To build on his jet-setting ways, he circumnavigated the globe by mail ship as well. Okay, third and final question from episode 74. What kind of bird supplied the weird eggs that fed the initial rush of Californians before there were chicken farms to feed the miners and sailors and other folks in the 1850s? The eggs were pointy and colorful on the outside and runny and clear on the inside. But for years, people risked their lives to travel to an island off the coast of California in search of eggs laid by a seabird called the Muir. How'd you do? Do you remember them all? A lot of episodes. All right, well, let's keep moving.
I'm a Sullivan. I'm in the Shepherd, and I live in Texas. And also, I love you! You're the goodest! Good time! And, my favorite episode is The Resolute Death.
In South Africa, it's typically hot in December, and 1938 was no different. As you might guess, hot weather is a bad match for a dead fish. Things can get pretty stinky pretty quickly. So, as many people in the city of New London were making arrangements for the Christmas holiday of 1938, they were probably startled to see the curator of the small museum in town as she frantically pushed a cart through the crowded streets, along with her assistant, a man named Enoch. This museum curator was Marjorie Courtenay-Latimer, and she was eager to protect the precious cargo in the wooden cart in front of her. In the cart was a big, dead fish. And her only focus was making sure that this big, dead fish, well over 100 pounds, did not spoil and rot in the warm weather over the Christmas holiday. Looking for a cool, safe solution, she rolled the expired sea creature to her first idea, the mortuary. The mortician was not amused.
"Are you out of your mind? You can't bring that thing in here. What will the families think if they find out?"
Okay. So, next she thought about the man who ran the cold storage. That building was filled with ice to chill food. Maybe he'd be cool with a stinking fish chilling in there too. No luck. At least he came outside to take a look.
"Yep, that's one weird big dead fish. Never seen anything like it."
Understandably, he didn't want the sea creature decomposing and stinking up the joint alongside all of his ice and food. Alrighty then. So, her last option was a taxidermist, which meant that only part of the fish would be preserved. The outside and the skeleton would remain intact, mounted like a trophy fish an angler might catch in a tournament. But this was no trophy fish. This fish could change history. Of course, in the hands of a taxidermist, this meant that the rest of the fish would not be preserved. No insides, no guts, no organs. They would have to be removed and discarded, which would later create a bit of an unpleasant problem for Marjorie. But for now, she had to do what she had to do, and she deeply believed that preserving any of the remains of this fish was a crucial thing to do. Marjorie Courtenay-Latimer was no stranger to nature and all of the creatures sharing space with us on Earth. Despite struggling with her health as a child, her family spent much time outside. Her father worked for the railroad in South Africa, which meant that they moved around a lot. And when she was a toddler, they traveled to the beach at the southernmost tip of the African continent. And at one point, the little girl fell asleep, clutching a seashell that she had fallen in love with and carried all day. There's another story from a few years later of her visiting a relative who had a pond. And in the pond lived a mother duck and her ducklings. Wading into the pond with determination, young Marjorie carefully collected the baby ducklings one by one. You see, it was her plan to sleep with them in her bed. Her parents gently said no to that scheme. Many years later, as an adult, she made a dream come true when she finally lived among the wildlife
for 3 months on the tiny, remote, and primitive Bird Island off the South African coast. It had always captured her imagination when she looked from the beach, and when the opportunity came, her parents agreed to join her. Despite the lack of nearly anything, no electricity, grocery stores, even newspapers, she learned much about the biology of the area and was constantly amazed by the natural beauty. While there, she also made friends with a Captain Hendrik Goosen, who was in charge of a fishing vessel that frequented the waters around the island. He'd bring her family things from the mainland, or else send mail and such back for them. It was a friendship that would eventually lead to a radical discovery. When she was just 24 years old, Marjorie was hired as the curator of the East London Museum, which had just been founded. The small building was mostly filled with trash and broken cases and a few taxidermied birds, which had been largely eaten by bugs. So she had her work cut out for her. Over the years, however, she collected specimens of plants, rocks, minerals, animal parts, and all sorts of other things, which she displayed and used to share her passion for the natural world. She even built an aquarium to hold fish. All the while, she traveled to other museums to spend time with experts and learn about new things to add and new ways to share her small museum with the curious public. During these travels, she made another friend, Dr. J.L.B. Smith. Dr. Smith was a professor and ichthyologist, which is a fancy name for someone who is a scientific expert of fish. He was very helpful both to her and the museum in East London. By the age of 31, Marjorie Courtenay-Latimer was established as a curator, and the museum had made great strides. And whenever her old friend Captain Goosen arrived at port, he made it a point to call her and let her know that there were fish and sharks his crew had caught in their nets, and she was welcome to come take a look and take what she liked. When he called on December 22, 1938, she thought about saying, "Thanks, but no thanks." But something in her head told her to go. It was a good thing, too. When she hopped on board the boat, one of the crew helping her sort through the catch noticed her face when she caught a glimpse of a very strange fish.
"I've never seen anything like it," he said. "We thought you'd be interested."
She definitely was interested.
"I picked away at the layers of slime to reveal the most beautiful fish I had ever seen. It was 5 feet long, a pale mauvey blue with faint flecks of whitish spots. It had iridescent silver blue-green sheen all over, and it was covered in hard scales. And it had 4 limb-like fins and a strange puppy dog tail. It was a beautiful fish, more like a big china ornament, but I didn't know what it was."
She thought of the drawings that she had seen in science journals. Not drawings of fish, exactly, but drawings of fossils. Fossils discovered all around the world. She thought of her ichthyologist friend, Dr. J.L.B. Smith, and she thought he needed to see this because she had a sneaking suspicion that she was looking at a living fossil. That fish, the one that she'd frantically pushed around town in a wagon to preserve, might be a fish that no human had ever laid eyes on before. Everyone assumed that it had gone extinct millions of years ago. Was this fish the long-lost coelacanth? She sent a letter to Dr. Smith with an imperfect but detailed drawing and waited to hear back. She waited and waited. And waited. He and his wife were out of town, plus he had papers to grade, so he didn't get the letter for days. And when he finally did, he stared in disbelief. An extinct ancient fish found alive in the waters of South Africa? Could it be possible? Could it be true? He barely slept for weeks afterwards because his mind raced with possibilities, excitement, and the wealth of new knowledge that this discovery could bring. He wanted every part of it to be preserved. A tall order, he knew, now that a week or more had gone by. It would still be weeks before he would be able to see it in person, So he asked Marjorie to save its innards. There would be much to learn from them.
You want me to save its guts? But they were pulled out by the taxidermist. Certainly they are putrid. Plus, I think they were taken to the dump.
Please try. Go to the dump.
For fish guts?
Yes, for fish guts. And science. So Marjorie asked for permission to scour the dump in search of the putrefying guts of the not actually extinct coelacanth. Luckily for her, the guts had been dumped into the ocean with a bunch of other fish parts. They were certainly shark food by now. So on one hand, this might limit what Dr. Smith could determine about the mysterious fish. But on the other hand, at least she didn't have to spend hours poking through piles of garbage for rotten fish guts. Almost 7 weeks after the discovery, Dr. Smith finally arrived at the East London Museum, and the fish on Marjorie's table had dominated his brain for nearly every waking moment. And when he saw it, he knew. It could have been one of those creatures of 200 million years ago come alive again. He knew that Marjorie Courtenay-Latimer had a coelacanth, a fish everyone believed had been dead for millions of years. It had only been seen in fossil form. But this was a real fish who only a few weeks before had been swimming, alive, in the ocean. If it was here, that means there must be more out there. People had been looking for these for decades, and here was the only one. It was a dramatic and incredible discovery. He prepared his reports and submitted to the most important science journals and societies. And after peer review and further defense, it was confirmed. This was an undiscovered species of coelacanth, living, not extinct, but related to many fossils found before the discovery. Like all living creatures, this fish needed an official scientific name. So Dr. Smith named it Latimeria chalumnae. Marjorie Courtenay-Latimer protested and said it shouldn't be named after her, but rather Henrik Goosen, the man who caught it. But Dr. Smith reminded her that she was the one with the scientific mind, the one who recognized it, and the one who acted to save it for study, and the one who understood what this discovery meant. Had it not been for her, it would have disappeared forever, and no one would have known. Before being sent for study to scientists around the world, Marjorie's coelacanth was put on display in the tiny and still relatively new East London Museum. Lines stretched around the block to see this amazing discovery. And that museum is still there today, and the preserved fish is still in its collection, along with many other pieces of natural and South African history. The coelacanth fish has remained elusive. It took another 14 years for a second living coelacanth to be found. This one was found off the coast of Mozambique. And Marjorie, she lived a long life, to the age of 97. She worked her entire career at the museum. And after retiring, she wrote a book about another one of her loves, flowers.
Hi, my name is Becky Chilton, and I'm from Winter Haven, Florida. And my favorite part about your show is Dr. Awkward, all your silly phrases and how you make even the most uninteresting topics interesting.
Well, here's something for you then, buddy.
It's Dr. Awkward, the palindrome professor. It's Dr. Awkward, the palindrome professor. It's Dr. Awkward. It's Dr. Awkward, palindrome.
Well, I asked who we should invite to celebrate with us for our 100th episode, and the answers were resounding. And as much as I didn't want to hear it, I listened to what you said. And you said Dr. Awkward. He's been on the show several times through the years, and his voice always changes. I don't know if you've noticed. But if you're not familiar, I have to warn you. Everything Dr. Awkward says is a palindrome. In other words, if you read what he said, like he wrote it down on the written page, you would see that everything he says is the same spelled the same backwards as it is forwards. I can't even make sense of it in my brain. It's so weird. Yeah. So, for example, if you read the words a Toyota backwards, it still spells a Toyota. That's a palindrome. So everything this dude says, he only uses the words and sentences and phrases that are palindromic. It's really special, I guess. So here we go. Joining us remotely on a phone call from a vacation in Italy is, I can't believe I'm saying this, our old friend, Dr. Awkward. What's going on, Dr. Awkward?
As I pee, I see pizza.
Okay, that's a strange way to start a conversation. I guess you are currently using the restroom while looking out of the window, maybe at the city of Pisa? Do you see anything out there in the city of Pisa?
A car, a man, a maraca.
Oh, okay, that sounds like a nice quaint scene to cast your eyes upon while you use the restroom.
A dog! A panic in a pagoda!
Oh no, it seems like your picturesque scene has turned sour. What caused the dog panic at the pagoda?
Senile felines!
Oh dear, I could see that driving a dog wild. I hope it's under control now.
Step on no pets.
Yeah, pets don't like to be stepped on, and I wouldn't try to control a situation by stepping on pets. Yeah, you're right. Hey, anyway, off the topic of pets and pagodas and all that. Hey, I bet if you're in Italy, when you're not staring out of a bathroom window, you've probably been eating some delicious food.
Wet rats and sanitary stew.
What? Gross! What about like pizza or pasta?
Go hang a salami. I'm a lasagna hog.
Now that's what I'm talking about.
I'm a lasagna hog. Go hang a salami.
That's kind of what you just said, bud, but I guess that's also a palindrome? Oh, okay, weird. Hey, what about pizza?
Yeah, pizza, zip, pizzazz, I pay.
Honestly, I think you owe me a pizza at this point, so I will gladly accept that pizza the next time that we're together. Hey, what did you get on your pizza in Italy?
Lisa Bonet ate no basil.
Lisa Bonet? She's a movie star. You're in Italy with Lisa Bonet? That's awesome.
Star? Rats.
She is a star. After you ate pizza with Lisa Bonet, I can't believe I'm saying that, did you have dessert?
Stressed was I ere I saw desserts.
Wait, it stressed you out to see the desserts? What, was there nothing that you liked?
I saw desserts. I'd no lemons. Alas, no melon. Distressed was I.
Ooh, sorry about that, pal. You know, I just, excuse me.
Yawn a more Roman way.
What? How do, yawn, or yawn? How do Romans yawn?
Yawn a more Roman way.
I think maybe spadiglio means yawn in Italian. Is that what you mean? Is that close enough?
In words drown I.
Well, now we've come to the point of our conversation, which seems to always come. It's the point where I get a headache. And I only have one Tylenol left.
Lonely Tylenol.
Yeah, lonely Tylenol indeed. Hey, is there anything else you'd like to say before we move on?
Kayak!
That's not what I meant.
Radar!
I meant, about our conversation today.
Was it Elliot's toilet I saw?
I guess that's kind of a callback, sure, yeah.
Sit on a potato pan, Otis.
Okay, I'm gonna call it there. Thank you, Dr. Awkward. Maybe we'll talk to you again. Or maybe we've run out of palindromes.
Dr. Awkward. It's Dr. Awkward. Palindrome.
And now a special word from Mick Sullivan, host of The Past and the Curious.
Oh, hi, friends. I want to take a minute to address a very important matter.
I've been making this show for quite a while now, since 2016. And if you've been listening, you'll know just how much this show has meant to me. And well, I don't know quite how to say this, but I think now might be the time to keep making more shows. Do you think I was going to quit? Nope, not now. There's too much work to do and too many stories to share. But very sincerely, I want to thank anyone who's ever listened, anyone who's ever sent a note, a piece of artwork, a You Have 30 Seconds, or just told somebody that they like the show and encouraged other people to listen. There has been so much encouragement to me along the way, and I am so grateful. And I have also all my kid podcast pals to thank. So many great friends along the way, like Eric and Melly and Miss Lynn and Lindsay and Marshall and more. All names that I hope you recognize, and I'm sure I'm leaving people out. But listen, it is important to have fun along the way. However, I believe life is about service. Service to each other. It is all of our jobs to make the lives around us better, more rich, and more meaningful. And it doesn't take much. We can all do that in so many different ways. I'm lucky that this is one way that I get to. But it's not the only way. And it is my hope that you, dear listener, do the same in the many different ways that you can. It's kindness that makes this life worth living. And if you look around, there is a lot of it. And it's your duty and mine to be a part of it. We're all in this together, and we can all make things better. I hope this show helps you in some small way towards that lofty goal. I think 2025 is going to be a really fun year for the Past and the Curious, so keep your fingers crossed for me in an exciting new project. And in any case, this has been a really fun 100 episodes. I love it. I have loved it and I still love it. And I love that you're out there listening and it means the world. So I'll keep making them if you keep listening. Well, there we have it, episode 100. And I have so many people to acknowledge who reached out and offered their congratulations and other offerings. It's a very international affair. But first and foremost, I must thank Patreon sponsors, Tucker Mata. Shout out to Tucker Mata. And also Sebastian Toro. Yeah, buddy. Tucker and Sebastian, thank you so much. Okay, let's get international for a minute, shall we? From up in Halifax, I have to thank Beatrice, but I can call her B. B Driver, thank you so much. And also, Ollie Goodman, who wrote me from Melbourne, Australia, to offer congratulations. And you have a birthday, like, really, really soon. Today, tomorrow, the day after? I'm not sure. Happy birthday, Oliver. Also, we've got Stacy, Tom, Lucy, and Alex, a family that listens in London in the UK. Hello to you. And also Tim and Cormac in the Netherlands. What's up, y'all? So glad that you're listening as well. But wait, there's more. There's Harper Moore, in fact. Harper Moore, thank you so much. And Abram in Kansas City, Missouri, thank you. River Teixeira, in North Carolina. Kate Holiday, I have to thank you as well. Also, Natalia Toro, that email you sent was really, really kind and touching, so thank you. And the people who sent art, oh, I love it. We had something from Steadfast, who sent me a picture of Mammoth Cave, and of course, Andrew Neal did these incredible brick builds of several different stories from the podcast, which are on like my Instagram feed as well. I gotta thank the Barrett family again for the nice note, and of course, I have to say thanks again to Colette Wombles. This is Colette in North Carolina, the coolest work of art I think I've ever seen. So it is now up above my workspace, so keep that in mind and feel good, because it makes me feel good too. Thank you, everybody. We'll be back next month. I'm going to have a really fun episode with an actual interview with a living person who has made incredible history, who I've gotten to know over the years, and she is spectacular. You're going to love it. Also, one last thing to let you know about. Usually the WBUR podcast festival in Boston is in April, but April during spring break is in conflict with Easter weekend and something called the Boston Marathon. I don't know. So they're moving it to February. I'm going to be there on February 15th. So if you want to come to Boston and hang out and see some great podcasters, the lineup is great. I want to see you, and it's kind of soon, I guess, really. So, February 15th. Or 16th. I'm on the Sunday of that weekend. So I'll tell you more later. Let's party. This is Mick Sullivan signing off from the 100th episode of The Past and the Curious. Bye, everyone.